Tonight on Odds and Ends, Cuba, land of the rumba. We'll be talking to pianist David Mayer Gonzalez, who's a protege of Chucho Valdez. David Mayer is the brightest new jazz artist coming out of Cuba. And tonight, we're going to have an intimate conversation with him all about his music, his life, and Cuba. Stay tuned. Welcome to Odds and Ends. Tonight's show is entitled Cuba, the Land of the Rumba. And we are featuring David Mayer Gonzalez, one of the most amazing musicians I've met in a long time. And also I played with him in Cuba. He began his career, I would say, at 16. He was playing with Oscar Valdez, a former member of the group Iraqueti. He went on to win the Joe Jazz Festival in 2004 and 5. And he also became the first Cuban to win the Berklee School of Music's National Presidential Scholarship. Since then, he has played with many, many, many stars in jazz. He's destined to be a star. He's a star already. And we're going to get into all the intimate details about how he got started, who were his influences, etc. But first, we're going to show you a small video clip of the man's talent and what he does.
I'm David Amir Gonzalez, a Cuban pianist and composer based in New York. I'm not just a jazz composer. I compose contemporary music. I compose the music of today. Piano for me was always part of my life. I remember that my dad used to play with Conjunto Rumbabana and Mirta Medina, La Isla de Sonora, and many of these bands used to rehearse it in my living room. And I always wanted to be part of that amazing world as a pianist too. The first jazz artist that I started listening, it was Chucho Valdez. I have been close to him for many years. He's one of my mentors, my dad first, and then him. Chucho Valdez with Iraguere impressed me a lot. The way he was writing for those brass sessions, the way Chucho Valdez sat down on the piano and had that amazing sound, really cultivated me a lot since the first time that I heard him. And then when I got into more the American jazz, I started listening to Chick Corea a lot. Oscar Peterson, I love him. When I got into high school in La Jena, the National School of Music, by the end of my first semester, my first year, I was heard by Oscar Valdez of Iraguere. I was picked up by the school to showcase this masterclass that he did. So in somehow, we got a really strong connection, and he decided to call me to be part of the second period of Diagala. I started my professional career playing for first time in jazz club full of people, being able to start making my first jazz solo, and also having the opportunity to write music for Diagala. So I made my first big arrangement in my professional career that was Manteca for Chano Bosso. And every time I come to Havana, I go to Jazz Cafe and they're still playing that song, Manteca, my arranging for Chano Bosso. I remember doing that tour 2007, we played that concert in Zaragoza, where we had piano in three generations. It was Chucho Valdez, Bebo Valdez, and I. Also, he beat me up to be one of those four piano players that I performed in 2008, opening the first night of Havana Jazz Festival. And then since then, Chucho Valdez has been pretty close to my music. And I remember that when I was preparing to do my audition for Berklee, I went to his house and he listened to all the music that I was going to prepare. And so he told me, man, if I feel so excited like that, I think that you will get them excited too when you do your audition. Berklee was always the dream school to attend to. It was an experience where I was surrounded with wonderful people. Wonderful students were all over the world. People with a strong root, a strong musical connection. Teachers like Joan Braquin, Danilo Perez. Those teachers really helped me out to grow as a musician a lot. I remember that I had to carry with the burden of listening people saying that, David Amir, you cannot make it. You are not good enough to be in the school. And I always had to be demonstrating that I can do it. In my first year of middle school, I had this teacher that I used to say that even though I was really musical, my hands were too little, too small to be a strong piano player, competitive piano player. I always knew that I was meant to be a piano performer.
I want to say quickly, thanks to Carnegie Hall to open the door for us to go in trance to David Gonzalez to bring a little bit of Cuba, a little bit of my music to this wonderful stage.
What's happening, mi hermano? How you doing, brother?
I feel blessed and I feel very happy to be able to finally be on this show. You know, we have been talking about it for a little while. So happy to see that we are connected in such a beautiful way. Beautiful way,
brother. Well, you know, I was all over Cuba myself.
Oh, man.
All over Cuba, man. I was trying to soak in all the music. You were born in a place that has such a powerful international reputation for producing good music. I mean, first of all, we start out, look at the three great percussionists, Candido Camero.
One.
Okay, let's talk about Mongo Santa Maria.
Before and after.
Or Chano Pozo, who Dizzy discovered, who he credits inspired him to write Manteca.
Totally, yeah.
But also, before we get into your music, I wanted to say that there was a movie with Al Pacino called Scarface.
I remember.
Nothing to do with the music, but Al Pacino played this character named Tony Montana. All the hip-hop artists said it became a hip-hop classic, not because you want to sell drugs, but they wanted to take his way of coming to America with nothing and then becoming the top of his game in that field. Tupac Shakur has a point where he mimics Tony Montana. We're going to show you a little clip of him mimicking Tony Montana before we go on.
Tupac. I'm going to tell you something, okay?
Don't say it.
The best thing for you to do right now is to leave me alone, okay? I don't think I have too special for you, okay? So back off, okay, fatty?
a classic.
Yeah, and then the Fast and Furious franchise, all the Fast and Furious movies, they actually shot a segment in Cuba.
Yeah, man.
Here they are shooting a segment in Cuba on the same streets that I was walking around every day. So it was really amazing. But now I want to get to you. Who were some of your influences? Did you listen to Herbie Hancock?
I did listen to Herbie Hancock, but every time I am approached to answer that question. It's very hard for me because I'm coming from different musical lineage. Let's say I had to break it down at least 4 or 5 to them. So one of my influences in the piano classical, European classical music, is Bach and Mozart. Those two are the two strongest. Bach, because the amount of contrapoint, the amount of polyphonic vision that he had, it was amazing. The same with Mozart, they're very clear. And then in classical Cuban music, Ernesto Lecuona, Manuel Saumel, so those Cuban classical pianists in the beginning of the 20th century. Then we have in the Cuban popular music, then we have, of course, Chucho Valdez, we have, of course, we have Gonzalo Rubalcaba, we have Omar Aportuondo. Then you have to come to American jazz. In American jazz, Herbie Hancock, Chick Corea, and Oscar Peterson are the three main influences, and McCoy Tyner, we hope the quartet and all the pentatonic and all the fusion. Those are the four pillars.
Did you ever listen to Bud Powell? Did you know and respect him?
Yeah, I do know him and respect him really well, very well. Of course, you know, if you want to be a good bebopper, you gotta really go to Bud Powell. You know, Art Tatum was very scary. Was very scary with the look, because I don't know, had like a small hands. So to reach all of those, you know, jumping in the left hand was very hard for me. So Bud Powell had a smaller hands, and I felt like a more connected to him. To, you know, to go the phrasing. You know, and definitely. And then in compositional music, you know, I go with Chick Corea, but a Chick Corea electric band, Yellow Jacket,
sure,
and Pat Metheny as a composer. The sound of that big sound of a lot of colors, counterpoints among the band. Those are my influences.
Now let's talk about Cachao Israel Lopez. He was considered the person to, I guess, invent or amalgamate the rumba. Is that correct?
Yes, Cachao is one of the main pillars, because in the, you know, the late 50s and 60s, he was the one who really put together what the transition between a Cuban son montuno into jazz, into Cuban rumba. So that's why Cachao was like a, you know, the one that we said that he's the main pillar for us to start building for the modernity of bass player sound.
Beautiful. Now, you know, American music, especially you know, popular music, is all based on the backbeat on the 2 and 4. But in Cuban music and Latin music, everything is based around the clave. Mm-hmm. Can you maybe explain to us what the clave is? There's two patterns, the 2-3 pattern and the 3-2 pattern. Can you maybe show people what that is so they understand?
Yes, basically Cuban music is mainly syncopated. That's why sometimes it's very complicated for Americans to, you know, to get into that, and Europeans, it's very syncopated. So as you said, 2 and 4 in American jazz, but then Cuban music is always in the upbeat yes. of 1, upbeat of 3, upbeat of 2, upbeat of 4. Boom, pa, 4. 2 and 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 4, 4, 2 and 4, 2. So that upbeat really get the Cuban music what it is. But at the same time, there is one element that is very important. It's the Cuban conga.
Yes.
Chica paco, chica pipi, chica paca, chica pipi. I always tell everyone that if you really want to nail Cuban music, the biggest secret, listen to me very carefully, the biggest secret is that you are able to put into your soul the conga pattern. That's, we call it sabor, the flavor, the packet coming from the conga. So you need to be able, the same way if you play American music, that you have to be able to do like the big band drumming thing. Our drums is the conga drum. So you gotta learn this chica pa chica pim pim chica pa chica pim pim. So based on the conga, the clave goes inside that, because if you do this chica paco chica ping papaco chica 4 1 2 4 4 2 3 4 until la 4 1 2 and 1 2 4 that's the clave right there, exactly. Yeah. And then if you do this chica paco chica 4 papaco chica or bit of 4 chica paku chica kung fom pa paku chipa kupa kupa that close the other way with the rumba clave. Chica paku chipa binga pa chipa kubing papa in the pa 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 pa. So yeah. Based on the clave, based on the conga drumming, this is where you understand where the clave goes.
Yes, that's beautiful. Now another thing I want to talk about briefly, the Buena Vista Social Club, when that documentary came out with Ry Cota, that basically brought a knowledge to the world about Ibrahim Ferrer and all these Cuban musicians who basically had gone unknown. That was a very, very important film. Does that Buena Vista Social Club still exist, or is it actually gone? Was it just done for that documentary and it's now over?
Well, it's never going to be over, because now you have the new generation. The new generation coming up with that. But I wanna just do a brief stop about Buena Vista Social Club. It's good that you brought it to it, because let's say, in 1960, when the Cuban Revolution took part, it happened that Cuban music wasn't able to be exposed in the United States in the biggest record labels and radio and promotion. That's why in many ways, Cuba and Puerto Rico, Cuba and New York, Rican salsa became two different patterns in a way. Cuba started developing our own way of cooking our own music. So let's say that we were having a tremendous amount of development in Cuban music, with songo, with los bamban, with Chucho Valdés y Daquere, with the Cuban timba, the Cuban rumba, everything that was happening in Cuba, since it didn't have the exposure in terms of radio, TV, or the big media exposure in the US, Americans, and mainly even a little bit of Europe, but mainly United States, didn't have that exposure to that music. What happened is in 1996, 97, 98, when this documentary film came about, many Americans said, well, oh, wow, I remember that I used to hear a country that is called Cuba that they used to have American music, great music. I said, excuse me, we have had for 60 years amazing music in Cuba. You haven't been able to go to experience it firsthand. Right. But, we always say kudos to Buena Vista Social Club, because that umbrella, that project create a platform for mainly Americans to to come back to Cuban music, to expose Cuban music again back in the Grammys, to a different type of property. And then from there, Chucho Valdés, myself, and a lot of different established and newcomers like myself, have been able to have more exposure in the U.S. thanks to that.
Yes.
And then, just to finish in this segment, it's just like I always said in my concert, but remember, Cuban music is not only Buena Vista Social Club traditional song. Cuban music is also Cuban jazz. Cuban music is also African, Cuban stuff. There is a lot around Cuban music that I would like you guys, I'm talking about in general, to experience and go to Cuba.
Also, me being in Cuba three times and playing there, I heard rumba everywhere and Afro-Cuban jazz. But the music that hit me in my heart the most is when I heard singing the African chants, just percussion, and they were singing the African chants. Maybe they were singing in Yoruba. That stuff hit me in my soul. I could understand why the Yorubas visit you, because you feel the power of that, and you understand how strong that is, and probably still is. That's the backbone of Cuba. Africa is still the root, man, of all Cuban music.
Now we say we actually maintain a strongest, the African, West African tradition is strongest in Cuba than even in Nigeria, Benin themselves. Because, unfortunately, Christianism and all of that came to those area in West Africa and just wiped out, their belief. They made all those black brothers becomes Catholic or Muslims or Christians, and they in a way they were wiped out of their own Yoruba belief. But in Cuba, with the Atlantic slave trade, we were able to, the same thing happening in Candomblé, in Bahia, Yeah. Of course, the same happens kind of similar in Haiti with the voodoo. With the voodoo, it's similar.
All the so same group.
Same group.
Santeria, voodoo, all the same.
Yeah, exactly. So now, we're able to keep it. Yeah.
Yeah. Now, does this interplay somehow with the Bakoso?
Bakoso, yeah. Bakoso is definitely it's a way of expression. It's a personal expression that is coming from the West African slave as well. And it was mainly in Santiago de Cuba, in the northeast of Cuba, coming from Haiti, coming from Jamaica into Santiago de Cuba, Guantanamo. And there is a big documentary about Bakoso that is beautiful. I don't know if you guys saw it.
I saw it, yes. Someone sent it to me and said, look at this new music. And I'm like, it's not new to me. I did three albums with Manu Dibango from Cameroon, Africa. So Makosa, man. So it wasn't new, but I understand it's new in a new context because a new generation in Cuba has embraced it.
Totally. We have embraced it. We are, you know, for many years, in many ways, I would say, you know, the Cuban Revolution, Fidel Castro, and everything that happened politics in Cuba, it was trying to wipe out, you know, the African belief. You know, they wanted Cubans to be more Catholic, be more in that type of agenda. But you know, our beliefs were beyond, you know, any politics, and we were able to keep it and maintain it. And nowadays, I would say that 85% of Cubans are Yoruba, man.
Beautiful.
Black and white.
I want to do this right now. I want us to play a clip of one of your videos, Smiling. So we can see some more of your artistry. That's why we're here.
Now we are going to continue with a song that is called Smiling. And let's see how much you're smiling this song. I'm watching you.
See, that's incredible. I mean, you're already too good. And I think in a matter of time, you're just going to get better. Well, I remember you gave me this. This is your CD, The Grand Concourse. Remember this?
Love and hugs to you, big brother. Yes.
Well, tell me something. Why did you name this The Grand Concourse? Why? You have a love or affection for the Bronx or something?
Definitely. There is a lot of take to take away from that this title. One, love and affection from the Bronx, because it was the first city that opens the door to me, that brought me to New York City when I moved to New York in 2013. For 2 years I was in the Bronx, and in the Bronx it looks very similar to my El Cerro. El Cerro is the neighborhood where I grew up in Havana, Cuba, and it's very similar to the Bronx, rough in a way, in such a way, beautiful in a way, friendly, loud in another way.
Yes.
You know, all the spectrum, that's the El Cerro, that's the Bronx. And also, right. You know, the Grand Concourse is like Concourse is like a fairy tale, a place where people can find you. And I wanted to have that main stage as a concourse, you know, where you see people can come and meet me in this space, where it's gonna be my first album in the US after 3-4 years in the US studying. And that's the Grand Concourse, the big opening, the big encounter, the concourse, the encounter, the big encounter.
Now, you know, I came to Cuba with Chapman Roberts, Broadway Jazz USA. That's how this all began with me and you. So I was there 3 times, you know, and I walked all over Havana, Cuba. I saw all of the beauty. I felt that the people there, with little money, with little hope for advancement, they were all just so beautiful, so happy, so effervescent, you know. I loved what I saw in terms of the spirit of Cuba. Although a lot of the poverty I saw, it hurt living in a basement apartment. I would walk by and look in, and I would say, nobody lives there. I see kids playing, I go, oh my God, you know. So, you know, I gave away a lot of money. People would ask me for help because they couldn't eat or couldn't buy milk, food for their children. And I gave.
No.
And they wanted to know, do you want anything from me? I'm like, no, I'm doing this for you, for my heart, and for Cuba. You know, there's a whole lot of beauty there. It's amazing that with such poverty, that these people can create such beauty and feeling from their music, you know. I bought this CD from Feliciano Ajango. You know, I'm a bass player, as you know, you heard me. But I said, let me just see if I can get closer inside of the Cuban rumba.
Cuban timba.
He has some really nice techniques. And you say that you have worked with him?
I have worked with him. We have toured together in Europe. And Feliciano Arango, you already mentioned in the beginning of our segment about Cachao.
Yes.
Israel Cachao. Now we need to talk about Feliciano Arango, because in Cuba in 1990s, when the special period came about, you know, Cuba was going through a lot of a lot of pain, a lot of isolation, economical wise. But at the same time, musical was one of the most prolific times in our history, because the need of being hungry, the need of going out to find sources to be able to survive. When you are a creator, when you are a composer, when you are a songwriter, you absorb that type of thing that you know, you are a creator yourself. You know, you put all of that into your music. And the best, well, not the best, but one of the best periods of musical periods in Cuba was in the 90s, when we are suffering the most economical wise, but the birth of the Cuban timba was amazing. The Cuban timba, and Feliciano Arango was the bass player of NG La Banda, NG La Banda, that was in 1990s the first band who started the movement of Cuban timba. Cuban timba is basically a contemporary salsa. It's the contemporary salsa. Why? Because, you know, Puerto Rican salsa, New York Rican salsa, you have timbal, congas playing mostly the song and Cuban music of the 50s. Okay. Yes. Then para Cuba, what we did with the timba, one is we start inserting the sound of earth, wind, and fire, the sound of pastorio. That's every. And then when you have so now, since you have, instead of having syncopation, Cuban song with Puerto Rican music, okay?
Yes.
Now, with Cuba, starting now with the funk, starting now having the one and the three, and then by having the bass player and drummer playing funky on the one of the three, pianist and conga player, and everybody else have to go in the one, the three. Now the conga player change his pattern. So, and at the same time, then you have introduction, like jazz introduction, like one and two. So this is super, super funky, but I think that Cubans, they were screaming aloud, you know, everything that they were going through, but at the same time, in a positive way, we were putting through, we were expressing it through the music, through our creation.
Now I understand, well, every time I hear you, not every time, but mostly, you seem to use mostly acoustic piano. Do you use a lot of synthesizers and modern technology, or is it because modern technology and a lot of the best equipment was not and is not available in Cuba, so you basically just stayed playing with the acoustic? What I'm saying is, do you use the synthesizers at all? Samplers?
Well, two truths. One, I'm coming from classical piano background, so I have been all of my life playing in a Steinway or Yamaha nine foot piano. Also, because the economical strength in Cuba, we didn't have resources to access to a lot of synthesizers. And then, so when I came to the U.S. with 26, 27 years old, I came a kind of naked, a kind of lost in a way of using synthesizers. But the good news is that the new album that is coming up next year in April, May, that is called Vida, V-I-D-A, Vida, this album is coming with a lot of synthesizers, with a lot of acoustic and electroacoustic type of things, and I'm very excited for you guys to hear it.
Different textures.
Yes, many different textures, with choir. I'm singing myself a lot of different polyrhythms with a lot of chords. And I can't wait for you guys to hear it. Woo!
Beautiful. You know, and when I was in Cuba, I went to some of the music stores, and I had noticed that I felt that the quality of a lot of the instruments there were not as good as what we had in New York, the United States. And I guess it's because of the wood, electronics, technology, etc.
Well, I want to just stop you there for a little bit. For a minute, we are not talking politics, but I want you to understand, as I always say to everyone, every time I go to New York, Havana, every time I go to Miami, Havana, Madrid, Havana, that I see a lot of foreign people coming to Havana for first time, you know, I always ask them what to expect. And it's good to know that you can never, never, never compare New York City with Havana. First of all, you know, New York City is never compared, not even with Paris. You know, New York City is the capital right, of the world. But you know, Cuba, first of all, we are a third country, you know, we are a third country, third world country, and so we need to compare Cuba among Mexico City, you know, Panama, you know, the countries of our region, and everything that we have been able to achieve, even though we have one of the most insane political and economical embargoes imposed into Cuba for 60 years. I always said, you know, coming from New York to Mexico City, performing a couple of weeks ago here, I was coming here and, you know, I saw this lady saying, man, I love Cuba, but I heard, you know, everything that you guys are suffering there in Havana, pam, pam, pam. I said, okay, I would like to challenge all this, the last 12 president of Mexico City, to be able, I want to challenge the last 12 presidents of Mexico City from 1960 to now to see how much they would have been able to sustain a country like Mexico City if you have the United States imposing an embargo, economical embargo, right, against you. The embargo is something that I kind of like imagine. No, you cannot really, Cuba cannot be able to make trade in credit, by credit with any country. You cannot really make a lot of trade with different banks. And then if you have any Spanish, let's say any Argentinian country who make any deal with Cuba, the United States go behind and they make you a big fine for trading the embargo. So it's a big persecution, right, to really be able to isolate Cuba against the world. So we hope that said, of course, when you get to Cuba, there's no money to buy instruments. There's no money. You know, we only have this amount of money for me to do at least the most important thing, which is to have education and social things. So at least education, that for me, one of the biggest things that I always be able to be thankful about it, because, you know, you, when you are well educated, you go, yeah, to New York City, you go to Brazil, you go to Madrid, you go everywhere you can.
Anywhere in the world.
But you are a highly educated black man. But, right, you know, I want to see how many people in the third world country, even in first world, that I can say that they are as educated, as well prepared as Cubans are. Even though we don't have the Nikes in Cuba and the Macintosh in Cuba and the Apple in Cuba, but right, at least we can say that the least resources that we have, they have been at least given to the people.
Now, what would you say? Do Cubans have a high respect for Gloria Estefan? I mean, she was Cuban and she made it very big in America doing commercial music. Or you don't really talk much about her?
I respect her. I respect her. We think politics-wise, we think completely different, because let's say we had to live different experiences, different stories, and I will always you know, admire her music, her career. You know, that both Stefan have done, the Miami Sound Machine have been amazing, the movement that they have created. But, you know, they left their, you know, they were, you know, her, let's say, Gloria Estefan fathers was part of the Batista police, you know, police repression of Cuba. When, yeah, Fidel Castro took power, of course, his father had to flee Cuba because, you know, he was making a lot of crazy stuff in, you know, in Cuba. So basically what happened is that they had to flee Cuba, they had to be removed from their properties, they had to be, you know, leave Cuba, their country, with very early age. And I will always respect their story, because they had to live, they had to experience something different. Me, my side, you know, if Gloria Estefan listened to this, I at least I would like her to respect, let's say that I'm a black man who was coming from the South Bronx of Havana, Cuba, and I'm a black man with no pedigree, last name. I'm a black man who was able to have access to the best education, to study classical piano all the way to the University of Cuba, be able to graduate and conduct the Philharmonic of Havana for free, with, yeah, my smile and my talent and my commitment. I will say that I will count with my hands how many black men in the United States and even in Panama, in Peru, in Bolivia are able to have access to that education. So at least for that, I'm not saying that I forget about the other bad things that happened in Cuba, because I understand it.
Sure.
But at least if Gloria Estefan or anyone who represent that type of history see me, listen to this interview, at least they will respect that I was able to live a different story in the 90s, and the Cuban Revolution for me was very in favor to my family and to a black man like me with no resources, and see how much I was able to do.
I met many people in Cuba. I was surprised there is a big body of people who are very conscious of blackness. Black consciousness in Cuba, and some books I brought back. But I want, before we get into a political thing, which is a whole nother genre, I want to ask you about Paquito de Rivera. Is he respected in Cuba?
Yes. I mean, I would say the same. Paquito Rivera, Gloria Estefan, Celia Cruz, Arturo Sandoval, Bebo Valdez, yes, you know, those are amazing artists that are for us. They are the pinnacle of Cuban music as well. As Chucho Valdez, that didn't defeat, the same as Alicia Alonso, the same as Omar Aportuondo, the one who stayed in Cuba. So those artists living outside of Cuba, they are as important for our culture as the one who decide to stay. So the thing is that unfortunately, for political reason, for economical reason as well, because at the same time, you know, the embargo is in a favor of Cuban politics and also as well in the favor of American policy, you know, Cuban American politics, because there is a lot of money put into the government to support the embargo. And there is for years, a lot of millions of dollars that those organizations in Miami and Florida, they feed their family with those millions of dollars that they receive to try to defeat Cuba, defeat Fidel Castro. So neither the politicians in Florida want the embargo to end, probably neither the politicians in Cuba want the embargo to end, because those are, you know, let's say a very wide umbrella for them to, you know, do their BS, you know, that happened. So what I want to say is that each of them, the two groups, the one who decide to defeat in the 50s or in the 90s, and the one who decide to stay, they are both respected in Cuba, highly respected in Cuba.
Beautiful. And at this time, I really want everyone to see one more video of yours. So I want us to stop right now. I want to play that clip of you, okay?
Beautiful. Thank you.
Very beautiful, brother. Very beautiful. Very serious. And you know, I'm also happy that you always identify yourself as a black man. The problems that Cubans face, Africans, African Americans in the United States is all the same. But music gives us a voice, and it also gives us a way up and out.
Yeah, man.
But now I want to talk about the crown and glory. You're going to be performing at Flushing Town this Saturday, October 23rd at 7 o'clock, my brother.
Sí, señor.
Right? And you're bringing your band. How do you pronounce your band?
Habana en trance. En trance.
Habana en trance. So we're ready for you with our executive director, Ellen Kodadek. Sammy Abu-Shumahis, you know, Deputy Director Sean Choi. Everyone's been working very hard. We are really very excited for this concert to happen, and we're anticipating it's going to be great, as I know it is. I mean, you can't be anything but great. I've seen you several times performing. You have a certain suave that you bring to the stage, and you always seem to love what you're doing.
Man, I always seem, no, I love, this is for me, every time I perform, it's like the last time on earth, the last time I'm going to perform. Tomorrow is not promised, so
that's right,
I'm
bro.
Giving you everything.
Now, what will the show be like? Will it be just Afro, good, strong Afro-Cuban jazz, your own original stuff?
See, all arena stuff. I will also will have a little tribute to, you know, tribute to Chick Corea, a tribute to Chico Farril with the classical Cuban music, and a tribute to Chucho Valdez. Those are important influences in my career. I'm going to have a beautiful blend of a classical piano with a lot of percussive piano, with a lot of, you know, I would say dramatic type of sound, and then with some childish, like more, you know, there's a lot of chorus that I'm preparing for this special concert, because for a lot of years I have been really knocking the door at Flushing Town Hall to be able to perform. I'm happy that through you and through the foundation that I was able to, you know, make it happen. I can't wait, counting the days to make it happen.
Si, señor. Well, another thing I will say too, I was very honored and blessed to be able to bring Chico O'Farrell to Flushing Town Hall. I had the Chico O'Farrell Afro-Cuban Orchestra perform at Flushing Town Hall with my good friend, Todd Barkin, who has the Keystone Corner. You should know him. Ooh. And at that time, Artur O'Farrell, his son, was playing piano.
Definitely.
Of course, when his father, Chico, passed on, now he took over the orchestra, which is still going on. So I'm going to be waiting for this concert. I think I might show up there and surprise you. Okay? And this has been a wonderful conversation.
Likewise.
We haven't even scratched the surface. There's so much more folklore, myth, mystery, music, and magic that Cuba has to offer. Well, we can't talk about it all in this one episode. So maybe we will bring you back, okay?
More to come. Okay. Thank you very much.
Before we go, what happens after Flushing Town Hall? What are your next performances?
Oh, man. So after Flushing Town Hall, I will have a concert on the 5th of November, opening the Havana Film Festival, New York. Havana Film Festival, New York, opening night. I will be hosting that opening night.
In
New York City?
Wow.
In New York City. And then afterwards, I'm releasing on November 20th, my latest album, Dairamir Gonzalez Tribute to Juan Formel y Los Bamban. This is an album that I'm looking forward for you guys to hear it already and buy it and consume it. This is a tribute to Los Bamban, which is one of the most legendary Cuban salsa band in from the 70s to today's. Just a year ago, they had their 50th anniversary, and I make it a symphonic tribute to Los Bamban. And also, I'm releasing in December, late November, December 1st, a program that is called the Cuban Jazz Academy. The Cuban Jazz Academy.
Where? In New York?
No, that's going to be in New York, in Brazil, in the world, in Havana, everywhere, because it's an online curriculum where it's coming with books in Spanish and English, where I will have the ultimate guide, step by step, to learn Cuban song, Cuban rumba, Cuban jazz, and so forth. So it's gonna be a beautiful journey of chord progressions and my vision of how
you're
I compose.
A very busy man. You are a very busy man, and you and I still, we're gonna find a way that we can make some music together. Something very strong, combining Afro-Cuban elements, Brazilian elements, and funk. We want people to feel good as well as to have great melodies and harmonies.
Totally. No, I will do something live and now. I want to send you an invitation to perform with me on Saturday. And we are rehearsing. This is happening right now. So when you go to the concert, you heard that this happened just right now. And we are like that, improvising on the fly. So we rehearse Thursday and Friday at the Yamaha Artist Service in New York 50. Yes, Eileen. Yeah. So after, we are going to check out one song, So You to Shine with me on the stage on Saturday, okay?
Okay,
so
brother. I'm going to give you a call later on tonight, okay, my brother?
Eso. Much love and respect.
Beautiful.
Eso.
Thank you for watching Cuba, the land of the rumba, live. Let us know if you liked tonight's episode by leaving a comment. And don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube, Facebook, and Rumble accounts. So tune in next week. It's going to be sweet. On behalf of Andrew Kauslowski, myself, and producer Giovanni, good night and stay bright. Bye-bye.